All right, let's go ahead and get started. So good morning, everyone. Thank you so much for joining us this morning for the fourth webinar in the Let's Fix School Discipline webinar series, Disproportionate Discipline, Addressing Implicit Racial Bias and Suspensions. I'm Sarah Mojula, and I'm a statewide education advocate for Public Counsel Law Center. And before I introduce Tia Martinez, who will lead you through the majority of this very informative and very engaging webinar, I have a few things to let you know. So on the right side of your screen, there should be a go-to training toolbar. So all of you are muted so that Tia and I can't hear you. However, if you'd like to ask a question during the presentation or at the end of the presentation when we open for questions, use your chat function. You can ask a question directly there. And if we're able during the presentation to answer that question, we'll go ahead and do so. Otherwise, we'll answer all the questions at the end. If you're unable to use the chat function, please feel free to email me any of your questions at somojola@publiccounsel.org. Second, the webinar is being recorded, and the recording and PowerPoint will be available in a few days following this webinar. The PowerPoint is actually also available for downloading on the GoTo Training website where you just registered. If you're unable to get it, I can also email that to you. And especially if you need it now. However, you should be able to see Tia's screen, and she'll be taking you through the presentation now. Tia, would you go to the next slide, please?
Sure.
And then, so third, I wanted to briefly tell you about the How We Can Fix School Discipline Toolkits, and you should see shortly on your screen a picture of the front page of the hard copy of the toolkits. These toolkits were put together as a response to educators and community members who wanted to improve and change school disciplinary practices but didn't know how to advocate for them or where to start or how to pay for them. So this is a growing collection of ready-to-use tools for advocating and implementing alternative discipline strategies, and also for searching disciplinary data, knowing what the current state law and federal laws are governing discipline, and alternatives, highlights on alternatives that are working in schools to reduce suspensions, expulsions, violent incidents, and increase academic achievement. So the highlights are actual interviews with educators and community members about what has worked and what is working. They also talk very candidly about the challenges to implementing different practices such as positive behavior intervention and support, restorative justice, social emotional learning, etc. They are available for download at fixschooldiscipline.org. And Tia, if you would go to the next slide.
There's a delay.
Oh, okay. Yeah. Sorry, everybody. There's a little bit of a delay, or maybe it's the delay is coming. It might be coming from me. However, this slide just has information about fixschooldiscipline.org and what you can find there. And it also has our email addresses, and my phone number. If during the presentation you need to get in contact with me, if you need to, receive, and I'm seeing actually a couple of emails about, whether you can get PDFs of the slides and everything like that. So I will be monitoring my email during this webinar and making sure to answer any questions you have, and then we'll open for questions, afterwards. So without further ado, I would like to introduce Tia Martinez, who is an amazing researcher with the UCLA Center for Civil Rights Remedies, and has done a lot of work around discipline data, especially around boys and men of color, young men of color, in schools throughout California. She basically breaks everything down in such a way that it's very understandable. And so without further ado, I'm going to let her do that. So Tia, go ahead.
Great. Thank you, Sarah. I'm really excited to be here today. I'll say this is my first time doing a webinar. So I'm trying to visualize all of you. It's really strange to be giving a presentation and not be able to see people and have that feedback. So I'm going to do my best to do that. I also note there's a little bit of a delay on the slides. So if I begin either moving too fast or begin talking about stuff that isn't showing up because this has some animated stuff in it, please chat with me and tell me that's happening, okay? And I can slow down, okay? So let's get started. Okay, so I want to begin by just giving a kind of a roadmap to today's presentation, what we're going to talk about. We're going to begin by focusing on disparities in rates of out-of-school suspensions. And sometimes I'm going to use the term OOS. That's just short for out-of-school suspensions. We're going to look nationally over time and then do a deep dive in California. Okay, that's going to kind of set the stage for beginning to talk about what could potentially be driving these disparities. And one of the things we're going to make a pit stop at before diving into the implicit bias stuff is looking at the efficacy of suspension. So, you know, if these disparities exist, are they a good thing or a bad thing? Depends on the effectiveness of suspension in meeting its goals, right? Then we're going to turn to implicit bias, and we're going to review the research on implicit bias. And then we're going to end with strategies for reducing implicit bias and related behaviors. And then we're going to try to save at least 20 minutes for questions, okay? So one thing I want to add is I did this research and this presentation at the end of September, and I've continued to do this research. And just last week, I got to speak to one of the professors at Stanford who did a number of the studies in here, and really exciting stuff is in the pipeline that's specifically about school discipline. So that stuff hasn't been published. So I'm in the process of sort of negotiating with him to try to be able to do another webinar where we kind of have an early release of this information. But at this point, what you're going to see mostly is evidence from how implicit bias functions in other fields. Okay. And then just get excited because, you know, hopefully in, you know, 6 weeks or something, we can really then begin to delve into specifically how it looks like in schools between kids, teachers, around suspension, okay? So why don't we begin with the national picture, and the national picture over time. So I think it's easy to fall into the trap of thinking, you know, suspension is something that has always been around, it's always been with us, it always will be with us. This is how it is. It is just a fact, right? But when you look over time, up national level, it can look really different than this. You know, in 1973, 3.7% of all students were suspended once or more times during the school year. So a little under 4%, right? And you can see in this graph, as we travel up to 2010, you see a pretty constant upward creep of those numbers. And by the time you get to 2010, the rate has doubled. It's 7.4%. So that's, again, you had about four kids in 100 in 1973 getting suspended. By 10, you're at 7.5 kids in 100 getting suspended at least once over the year. So the rate is going up, and it's not just the overall rate for everyone. What I next look at the rates. Hold on, I just got a message that my the audio is going in and out. So I will just continue, and please, if the person who sent that says, if this is getting better, please just give me a heads up. Okay. So right here, what you're looking at in the second one, national risk of suspension by race of student, 73 to 2010, what we're looking at here is not only did suspension go up for all kids, but it went up the highest. It had the steepest increases among students of color. In particular, look at African Americans. So 1973, you have 6% of all students being suspended once or more, right? So 6 in 100. By the time you get to 2010, you're at 17%. And now this green line at the bottom are white students, right? So the blue line is Latino students. The purple line is African Americans. And you could think the gap in terms of the disparity between suspension rates of whites and Latinos or whites and African Americans is kind of this white space in between. So it's all this, you can see how it's getting bigger and bigger. Latino rates actually began in 73 below whites and are now above. So this part in the presentation, I usually ask people, do you know when the height of youth crime was? So when did we reach our high point in terms of youth crime? Because you'd think that these trends should basically map onto that, right? And the height was about right here, right? So the early 90s, mid-90s, right? So this, since then, there's been a steep decrease in every measure of youth crime. Yet, look, these rates continue to go up. So that really begs the question, what's going on underneath this? What I'm going to do now is we're going to deeper dive into California. What I want to talk about here is really what happens when we drill down on these rates, much like we did in the last slide, but I want to go even deeper, okay? I want to talk about, you know, here we are in California, 09, 10, or 7% suspension rate, right? 7 out of 100 kids were suspended one or more times, right? The question is, when all kids, right, K through 12, how does that look different when you look at elementary school students different from middle school students and high school students? And then how does that look different when you look at race? How does that look even further different when you look then by disability status, and even more different by gender, and ultimately, finally, by offense? We're going to walk through this, and I think the thing to pay attention to here is how the disparities grow. Okay, let's start with grade span. Now, this shouldn't be a surprise to anyone, right? So if you look at elementary schools in California, 3% of kids are suspended. So 3 out of 100, you know. This looks like the rate right in 73 for all students. But elementary schools are going to... Now, when you hit secondary school, in this case, it's myth. Right here, what I've done with the data is I've taken all the middle schools and high schools. I've excluded K-8s from the analysis because I can't determine. Right? It goes from 3% to 11%, so increases by a factor of 4. This is interesting, not surprising. I think it stays with us. What is interesting, though, is what happens when we look at further, and we say, let's look at it by grade span, and now let's kind of lay over that race, okay? So the blue bars here are rates of suspension among elementary students by race. Now, you notice that the African Americans are at 7%, right? Right? And that's much higher, but then the rest of the folks are all, you know, at 2% Latino, 2% white, you have less than 1% Asian, 2% students in English learner status, right? So they're about, you know, they're relatively equal. Now, the orange line is looks what happened when you hit middle and high school, okay? So the African-American rate skyrockets, 1 in 5. But so does the Latino rate here, going from 2% to 12%. The white rate goes up too, but not anywhere near the degree that the Latino rate goes up, right? It goes to 7%. Asian rate goes up. And then look at English learner status. So essentially what's happening here is you see, as you move from elementary school to middle and high school, the gap emerges, this gap for Latino students and English learner students between their rates and white rates. The next thing is to think, okay, what if we go one step further? Now, let's look at the secondary students, okay? But now let's look at the secondary students by race. Now, let's layer in disability and then gender, okay? So this top one right here, here we have bottom white students here, Latino students here, African-American students up here. So secondary students, so this is, again, this is that number from the previous page, right? This is the 22% of African-Americans, you know, more than 1 in 5 of secondary students getting suspended once or more in California in 09-10, okay? So then we skip up to the next one, this kind of orangish one. This is now African-American secondary students with disabilities. So it goes from 22% to 30%, right? And then climbs yet again once we say, well, now we're just going to look at the boys. So we get to a point where we're at male secondary students with disabilities at 36%. And if you think back to that early slide, we had 3% in elementary school, so sort of that's the low point, all the way up to 36% for secondary school students that are black with disabilities and male. You can see the same pattern, though, exists across all the groups. It exists for Latino students right here. And so you go from 12% all the way up to over, again, 1 in 5, nearly 1 in 4 male secondary students who are Latino with disabilities being suspended one or more time in 09-10. The same pattern with white students below. Disparities remain, right? But you see the same kinds of increases. And so here, again, I've circled, you know, these high points. I think that the white male secondary students with disabilities rate of 18% is brutally high for thinking about that being the comparison group, that being the low group. So what's really clear is that students with disabilities are facing multiple challenges. And this isn't totally intuitive, right? Because actually students with disabilities have a lot of legal and service protections. Like they need behavior plans, there's extra money for them. You wouldn't automatically assume that you would see more expulsionary or suspension among these kids. So this is more recent data. And so it is troubling. Then I want to end here on offense. So just looking at why were these kids suspended. So this was 09-10. There's about, 710,000 out of school and in school suspensions given in 11-12, right? And 48% of them were under this category called willful defiance. And now, as many of you may know, willful defiance is, akin to disobedience. I mean, it's a big, giant, vague category that can include a lot of different stuff in there, right? It's what you would call an ambiguous, a vague category. But it accounts for about half of all of the suspensions. Now, the next one is looking now at the unduplicated students, right? So that was 710,000 out of school, but 540,000 This was just out of school. And you see, when you just look at out of school suspension, it's 40% willful defiance. Now, why is that important? I want to just pause here. And before I go on to this, I want to address the question that came up. And it says, why doesn't the study include Native Americans, which are significantly higher than African American suspension? This is a great and incredibly important question, because these rates are among Native Americans in California are it's basically the second highest group. The reason that we can't do that is because we were using data that's a sample. And what happened is, because of the sampling technique, when we tried to stratify to look at secondary versus elementary, you got this huge undercount for a bunch of technical reasons. And it really understated the extent of the problem. So we didn't want to put that up there because it would understate it. We're currently working now with a set of data, which is basically every school reporting on every student. And we're going to be able to have really great granular data on Native Americans. So thanks for that question. So we just talked about the offense, and there is a connection here about, we saw how the levels of disparity grow by race, by gender, by grade level. There also, we're seeing that the level of disparity grows by the type of offense. So if you can think of kind of two big categories of offense, we have this willful defiance one, which is sort of vague and broad. It can include a lot of things, right? A big range of things. Versus suspensions for other more serious and less subjective categories, like bringing a gun to school, like all of the other things that are very concrete. So in this category, what we included were offenses involving weapons, drugs, and violence with injury. Kind of thinking of those as where you have pretty concrete evidence of what happened. Willful defiance being more vague, right? Now, on this slide, we're looking at a slightly different measure, okay? Before, we were looking at risk of suspension, and that's sort of like the probability of a student being suspended one or more times. It's like your chance of being suspended. In this incidence, we don't have the unduplicated students, so we don't have the number of students who are suspended. What we have is the number of suspensions. So these are really, these numbers are read like this. Let's start with the offenses involving weapons, drugs, and violence with injury. So the blue is white, and the orange is black, okay? Okay, so the suspensions among white, you had for these very serious offenses with concrete kind of evidence and definitions, you had 1.6 per 100 suspensions, per 100 students, For 100 white students, there are 1.6 suspensions. Now, you notice it's higher among black students, 4.5 of these suspensions, right, per 100 black students. And so you have a gap here of around 3 suspensions. So in other words, what we're saying here is African-American students have about 3 additional suspensions per 100 students than the white students. Now let's go over to willful defiance. That's this next category right over here, okay? So here we are again with white students at about 2.4 suspensions per 100 students. Now look what happens with African-Americans. We go up to fully 10.1 suspensions for willful defiance for 100 African-American students. And what that means is this gap here, this gap has gone from being 2.9 to being about 3 African-Americans having 3 more suspensions per 100 students to African-American students having nearly 8 more. That's pretty powerful evidence of level of disparity. But that still begs this question about whether these really are, like, are these disparities a bad thing? You know, when you use the word disparities, it sounds bad. But whether these are good or bad really depends on the evidence of the effectiveness of out-of-school suspension. And it depends on that evidence of the effectiveness of this. Think of it as an intervention on both the students suspended and on, as well as the other students in the classroom. And, you know, what would happen if that student were suspended or not suspended. So I just want to kind of go through the rationale and talk about some really powerful research that has emerged in the last couple of years. I mean, I think we can say things with so much more scientific certainty about the impact of suspension than at any time in the last 20 years. Okay, let's talk about the impact of out-of-school suspension on the students suspended. This is the idea. Is out-of-school suspension helping misbehaving students to change their behavior in ways that enable them to stay in school longer, learn more, and graduate at higher rates? Okay, so this is, you know, this idea relies a lot on the idea that there's a learning cycle involved. You get suspended, you realize that was serious, you improve your behavior, you're in school more, you stop misbehaving, you're paying more attention. So that's the kind of cycle that we'd imagine is going on. Now, so what we've known for a long time is if you look at the rates of dropping out among students who were suspended and you compare them to the rates of dropping out among students who weren't suspended, they're much higher among students who were suspended. And advocates for a long time said, see, this is a very bad thing. Now, I would encourage you to be really wary of that kind of data, okay? Because it's very likely that there are some really, really important differences between the kids who got suspended and the kids who didn't get suspended, okay? And that those really important reasons, like let's say the kids who got suspended were really struggling academically. And they were more, because they were sitting in class and they weren't understanding what was going on, they were misbehaving and they got suspended. Eventually they drop out. Their dropping out, though, is driven much more by the credit deficit they're in, which is really much more about their level of academic achievement. So you're picking up on something else. So we needed a different kind of study. And we recently got it from Texas. So amazing study. From the Council of State Governments, looking at, I think it was like almost a million sixth graders, something mind-boggling like that. Just the thought of a million sixth graders is overwhelming. So it followed almost a million sixth graders all the way from sixth grade through, I think, a year after 12th grade. So, and Texas collects every piece of data you could imagine, like the amount of data that they have on the student and whether there was a teen pregnancy and whether what the parents were doing and their education level. So you have this really rich data set of longitudinal data on kids. What they were able to do is basically get a kid, pick out, the statistical procedure does essentially this, okay? You take a kid out, right, and you take the kids who were suspended, and you want to compare them. You don't just compare them to kids who weren't suspended. You take that kid who was suspended, and you compare it to another kid, but you're going to control for all those things that could be different. For instance, control for their test scores, control for their grades, control for the kind of school they're going to, control for where they're living. So control for all of this stuff that could be alternate explanations, right? And when they did that, and this included things like they were able to control for, that number of teachers the percent of teachers that were either certified, the level of experience, how the school was run, they were able to control for how the district was run. what they found out that is even after controlling and holding all that constant, those kids who were suspended were twice as likely to repeat a grade following that suspension. Okay, and I think probably most stunning is they were three times as likely to have contact with the juvenile justice system. And this is some of the most concrete, powerful evidence about the school's prison pipeline that we have. And because it's so meticulous in terms of controlling for those alternative explanations, we are at a point right now where we can say that for that student suspended, that the suspension is harmful. There's no for their own good rationale that we have anymore. And the other thing that always makes us question the effectiveness of suspension. Remember, I said that there were 710 suspensions in and out of school, and I think there's something 400 or 500,000 unduplicated students. So when you look at those two numbers, immediately what jumps out is this frequency of repeat offenders, right? And again, if the suspension was incredibly effective at preventing this behavior and stopping reoffending, then we wouldn't see those numbers being so wildly different. But this still, though, begs another important question that we really need to take seriously. And this is about not the impact of out-of-school suspension on the students suspended, but the impact of out-of-school suspension on the students and staff left there who don't have to be in the classroom with that student anymore. And the idea here is we want to know, is out-of-school suspension making schools safer and more productive for the non-suspended students, thus enabling them, right, because there's less disruption and there's less waste of learning time, to stay in school longer, learn more, and graduate at higher rates. And so there's been a number of studies that have looked at this. The one looked at states, the level of suspension, and whether they had higher or lower NAEP scores. And the NAEP score is kind of the gold standard student achievement test that's given. And what they found is that states with higher suspension rates have lower NAEP scores. But again, I would caution against that, right, because a lot of other things could be happening. A much stronger study looked at higher suspending schools, in a Midwestern state, higher suspending schools those schools that suspended at greater rates have below average test scores compared to the scores in demographically similar schools. So in other words, this basically said, okay, we see that the higher suspending schools are lower achieving, but that could be for a lot of reasons. But then they controlled for poverty, they controlled for race, they controlled for those factors, and still the schools with higher suspension numbers had significantly lower achievement rates. And then the final piece, which kind of goes to the core of this presentation, and I'll just keep coming back to again, but the best predictor, this is out of a study in Chicago, I looked at safety and the rating of safety of schools by teachers and by students and by parents. And the best predictor of safety is the quality of the relationships inside the school building. So the degree to which a kid feels safe has everything to do with the quality of the relationship between teachers and the quality of relationship between teachers and students. And so at the core of this is this very important piece about building strong relationships. The next question, so if we've kind of established there are disparities. We think these disparities are pretty troubling. So what explains these disparities? And, I've thought a lot about this, and I know a lot of you guys have too. So there's many, many, many possibilities. You have family factors, you have things like parenting style. So but actually, before I go on this, I want to say, remember, these are explanations for disparities in suspensions, not explanations for overall high rates. So when we talk about what the possibilities are, these need to be things that are happening to students of color at greater rates than white students, right? So one of them is family factors, right? And this could be parenting style, parents' level of education, absent fathers, poverty, low-wage work, and joblessness. You know, parents with mental health issues or drug abuse issues, domestic violence. And then there's student factors. You have sort of low lagging academic skills, poor self-regulation, and this is all the student, underdeveloped social and emotional, peer norms, students' mental health or substance abuse, child abuse, definitions of masculinity. And then a really important category that we pay a lot of attention to is the education system structures and policies. And this is based on the idea that our school system's pretty segregated, right? And that students of color are very often in a school system, in separate school systems, separate schools, separate districts. So the first piece here is sort of vague or biased rules, like in the code of conduct. So this goes back to the willful defiance piece. Second piece is unequal financing, inexperienced teachers concentrated in segregated schools, class sizes so big that you can't build relationships, limited classroom management skills, inadequate school district standards, school and district level leadership and standards-based accountability. Then there's neighborhood stuff, and this is familiar, violence, gang activity, concentration of poverty. And finally, there's explicit intentional racism, unconscious, unintentional bias, and either forms of those two, right? The explicit bias or the unintentional bias expressed in lower expectations. Now, these first four, I care deeply about. This work is really personal to me. You know, my father was a crack addict. I lost my younger sister at 25 to suicide. I am so darn serious about addressing all of those. Sometimes to a fault. And I have only recently begun to do this sort of exploration of the role of bias, and in part because of what the data shows, in particular unconscious and unintentional bias. And that's what we're going to talk about today, okay? What is implicit bias? So implicit prejudices are social preferences that exist outside of your conscious awareness or conscious control, okay? You are not aware of these, okay? These are attitudes that are understood to reflect associations, automatic associations between some set of social categories like black, white, old, young, and some set of evaluations like good, bad, smart, dumb. Implicit bias, we're not saying that people are hiding their racial prejudice. They literally don't know that they have them. So it's not about deceiving or lying. In fact, you know, the vast majority of those with implicit biases hold either no explicit biases or relatively mild explicit biases. And I think it's important to try to give some thought to how this works. So what's going on? It's out of our consciousness. We can't control it. What's going on? And it's really helped me to understand that this is how it works. Hold on, I'm cutting out a bit, so I want to... Okay, this is how it works. It's really relying on the same cognitive processes that help us to learn and that ensure our survival, okay? So this is just our brain working as it should be. So I want to begin with the learning part. You know, we learn through pattern repetition. So when two concepts become associated with one another in memory, right, we have these automatic scripts in our brains. So when we see one, automatically we recall the other, right? Think about memorizing your times tables, right? Now, these automatic scripts mean that the association and related recall is super, super efficient. So it doesn't have to go, you're not sitting there going 3 times 2. So let's see, 3 plus 3, you're just going straight to 6, right? So this is an incredibly important piece. If we had to send everything up through our prefrontal cortex, the higher levels of thinking, that is a slow process. That's a grinding process. And we would not be great learners. And we also would be scared too. We also would not be that capable of reacting to threats in the way we need to. So in the context of racial bias, this is how it works. So people with a negative implicit racial bias towards blacks will more quickly and easily respond to concepts associated with the negative stereotype of blacks than with concepts that are not associated with that stereotype. So in other words, we live in a world where we have been sort of marinating. You know, talk about like pattern repetition. In this constant association of African Americans with violence and criminality, over and over again on TV, in movies, and it's in the news, in every way, we have exactly those conditions that drive something to become automatic, right? Over and over and over again, over and over and over again. And it's automated. Once it's automated, it's functioning, you know, underneath your conscious control. So the thing is a really interesting study looking at individuals who had high levels of implicit bias towards African Americans. Now, the brain, this is the part about threat. The brain has the threat detection center, the amygdala. That's the part of the brain that's like, this one researcher calls it the uh-oh center. It's when you're like, oh my God, something bad's happening. What it does is it closes down those higher brain functions. It says, listen, you are going to have to run or you're going to have to fight. So it's like a flight-fight response, right? And this center of the brain looks like it plays quite a prominent role in implicit bias. So when they looked at folks that had high levels of implicit bias, they put them in the scan, MRI scanning thing, and they projected photos of white people and of black people, and they looked at what was going on in their brain. When the pictures of black people came up, what they saw in those folks with really high levels of implicit bias, remember, this is not explicit bias, right? Implicit bias is the amygdala lighting up. So, the amygdala is like a siren. It's saying threat, fear. So that's kind of an understanding of what's going on in our brain and why this is happening. I want to give you guys an experience of what it feels like. When this happens, because this happens with lots of stuff. It can happen. Race is a particularly salient place that it happens and an important place that it happens, but I want to do this exercise with you. So this is going to be kind of hard because I usually do this in person, and part of the cool part is you get to hear each other doing this. So I need you guys all to really do this in earnest. So I'm going to put up on the screen here. See it? Please, someone tell me when you have it up. Okay, I think good. Great. Thanks, guys. So, what I want you to do here, this is called a Stroop test, okay? I want you to ignore the word. All I care about is the color the word appears. Okay, I just care about the color of the font. That's all, okay? So I'm going to point to them. Can you see my cursor moving down like that? So, okay, cool, great, thank you. So what I'm going to do is we're going to go down, and I want you to say the color of the font aloud. And you have to say it aloud. I'm going to say it, and I'm visualizing all of you saying it, okay? So let's start here. What's this? See, red, orange, green, brown, pink. Hold on. There's a bunch of you who aren't doing it. Okay, we're going to start again. You really got to read it aloud, okay?
Red. I'll do it.
Red. Orange.
Green. Brown. Pink. Green. Blue. Yellow. Red. Yellow. Blue. Green.
Okay.
Orange.
You got that. Okay.
Got it.
All right, Sarah, next one. So now what I want you to do is the same exact thing. Ignore the word and simply name the color that the word appears. Sarah?
Wait, it's not up yet.
Oh,
okay, now
I see. Okay, great.
Green, blue, red, blue, pink. No, red. yellow, blue. No, red. Blue, yellow, blue, white, green, yellow, green.
Great.
Pink.
Thank you. So hopefully you guys had some experience of what it feels like to do that. It's like literally you feel your mind fumbling, right? You feel you can feel the delay. You can feel yourself even when you're getting the font color right, almost reading it, you know. And the idea here is that there are things that you might try to ignore, but try as you might, you know, just like the meaning of that word comes through, disabling your ability to name something as simply as the color of the object, right? Those associations come through. Great. I got a great input that having Sarah do the exercise really enabled the sense of being in the virtual room. Good. I'm going to get better at this, but you know, I'll be able more to use chat, but we'll improve as time goes on. So but the idea here is, listen, reading is something you have been doing for most of your existence, right? And it's been pounded into you such that, you know, and you probably knew your colors before you read, right? So you've known your colors even longer. Nevertheless, when you see the word red, even though you know its font is green, the word red comes flying out of your mouth. That is implicit bias. That is the experience of it. Yeah. And the idea is that that same experience happens with social categories and people's attributes, so race or gender. Let's talk about how we measure this, okay? So the Harvard Implicit Association Test, I provided this link right here. I don't know how many of you have ever taken this, but I urge you to take it, okay? It's a really informative test that can, it's going to give you a sense of what your implicit attitudes are. And this is how it works, okay? So you're at your computer and you have a right button and a left button, right? And so you're going to get a bunch of images of faces, right? And of words. You get a black face or a white face. And so at first they say, well, you know, the black face, hit the right button. And white, if you see a white face, hit the left button. And then they do the faces. You'll write left, right, left, right, left. Then they put up, instead of black and white as the two categories, good and bad, okay? And then you have a bunch of words, and they're words like depression. You're like, oh, yeah, that's bad, and bad's the left button. Go through all those. It's pretty easy. But then they mix it up, okay? The next thing they do is they say, now they put, here's what the right button means, and here's what the left button means. And the right button now means, it might mean good and white. And the left button means bad and black. You then get a mix of faces and words, and you go through it. You feel yourself, you're doing it. Then they flip it on you, right? So now good is sharing the same button with black, and bad is sharing the same button with white. And you experience, as you go through this, the same experience that you had trying to identify those colors. There is a slight delay. There's an effort, something automatic. You're pushing, you can feel this automaticity. So individuals who associate black with bad, and remember, this is unconscious stuff, for example, respond more slowly when black and good share the same response button. Now, I took this test, and I was a complete and utter disaster. I mean, I'm a civil rights researcher and lawyer. I've spent my life doing this work. I am Latina. I am gay. And I completely came up, basically, as having an automatic preference for white people compared to black people, an automatic preference for white people compared to Latino people, an automatic preference for straight people compared to gay people. I mean, every category I was a part of, and I was just, I literally blushed when I looked at the results. And I was alone with my computer. It was just, oh my God, I can't believe this. But again, back up to thinking about the world we're in, like the stew, that what we're marinating in, and that those learnings are happening and they're getting automated and they're existing below consciousness. So what you see here is this percent of the, what this is looking at all the people who go, and they've done over a million of these implicit association tests on the web, how people break down, okay? So you can see here that you have 70%, right, of folks who take this show anywhere from a slight to a strong automatic preference for white people, right? Only 17% show no preference, and 12 show a slight to strong automatic preference for black people. Now, the interesting thing is these findings, this kind of distribution happens across people of different races and of different ideological kind of categorizations. There is a relationship between, when you take this, they're going to first ask you if you have a preference for a certain type of people. So I have a strong preference for white people, or a strong, or a no preference, right? And that's kind of what they're calling that, the measure of explicit racism, right? Then they also have another one that's a little more subtle, and they ask how warm you feel about different groups. You know, and you can go from very warm to very cold. And it's like, well, I feel, you know, medium warm with Latinos, and I feel, you know, and so it's not, so you're going to get a more nuanced thing. So when they do that and they look at the relationship between what people say explicitly and implicitly, they, you know, there's definitely a relationship. it's there's a moderate relationship, but not a strong relationship. You know, this is not like the, you know, this isn't the driving piece, isn't the explicit stuff. It's the driving piece. And so about over 70% of white people show this preference. Over half of black people show somewhere between a slight automatic to a strong automatic preference for white people. And this one thing that's interesting is that these preferences are shown despite people saying that they either have no bias or a relatively minor bias. Interestingly, for African Americans, in on that warmness scale, even though you had actually a decent number of African Americans saying they had greater levels of warmth for other black people, still the average, even though you had that distribution when it was asked explicitly, still on average, African Americans came out with a slight automatic preference for white people compared to black people. So this just to me is like we are all in this together. We are all living in a world where we are exposed to this pattern, repetitive associations between race, criminality, violence in really powerful, powerful ways. The question that remains, though, is does this affect how we act, right? So if everyone has these implicit biases and they're underneath here, they're like below the consciousness, right? That would be all right if it doesn't translate into behavior, right? Like, so you don't know about them. They're there. If you take this weird computer test, they show up, but they're not really, you're not acting more discriminatory. So unfortunately, that's not the case. So what I'm going to show you is some research from other fields that looks at how the relationship between levels of implicit bias measured, as we talked about on the implicit association test, and behaviors. In this case, we're going to start with physicians, treatment decisions, okay? This is a recent study that looked at pediatricians pro-white implicit bias. So as pediatricians pro-white implicit biases increased, so as they had a stronger and stronger automatic preference for whites, they were more likely to prescribe painkillers after surgery for vignette subjects who were white as opposed to black children. So the way the study went is first the doctors took the implicit association test, then they were read a vignette. You know, they were given, this is the family, the kid has just had surgery and is experiencing pain and needs more painkillers, what do you do? And what they found is first that on average, doctors, regardless of what the implicit biased test showed, were more likely to prescribe to white children as opposed to black children, but also the likelihood of prescribing to white children was associated with the implicit bias. It was not, they also checked to see if it was associated with explicit bias. Explicit bias didn't predict it. It was only the implicit bias. Next, police officers and the decision to shoot. So repeated studies have shown that police officers are more likely to mistakenly shoot unarmed black suspects than unarmed white suspects in a computer simulation. Levels of implicit bias also predict bias shooting behavior. So so the computer simulation creates pictures of people with ambiguous things. Is that a wallet? Is that a gun? Right? And over and over again, if the person with that ambiguous object was black, there was more likely to shoot that person when actually it was a cell phone or a wallet. Okay? And importantly, they could connect that to the implicit bias, so that the higher the level of implicit bias on that test, the more likely they were to mistakenly shoot. The next category is hiring managers. This is about the decision to hire. So they looked at a study in Europe looked at employment recruiters in Sweden, right? And they looked at those, and they had them all take the implicit association test, right? They rated them, and then they did a sort of the classic study where you give basically resumes that are basically incredibly similar with different names on them, and the higher the score on the implicit stereotyping test on the test, the more likely they were to offer Arab the less likely they were to offer Arab applicants job interviews. So this was Swedes implicitly favoring native Swedes over Arabs, so under consciousness, not explicit, that when they decide who they're going to call back from all those resumes they get, they're less likely to offer Arab applicants job interviews, even though the resumes have been constructed to be similar, right? Similarly, in a different one, the scores on implicit stereotyping tasks, so again, scores on that test involving race and intelligence and how they were connected, were correlated with students' likelihood of selecting resumes with African-American names. You're probably familiar with the study that was done about whether people got callbacks when they submit the resume based on whether they had a name that was typically African-American, right? This then looked at saying, actually, it's not just that that's happening over and over, but you can actually see that the higher the person is scoring on this implicit association test, the more likely they were to end up not selecting those resumes with African-American names, even though, again, they controlled so that the qualifications were the same. And this is really important, especially among participants who felt rushed, okay? When they had to do this quickly, come on. And like anyone who's worked anywhere, you know what it's like to get that big pile of resumes, right? This is something you're going through quickly. Another one that's not on here, but that is worth mentioning is sentencing and judges. Okay, so some really important research has been done looking at the length of sentences and the darkness of the defendant's skin, or the how stereotypically African their features appeared. And basically what they saw is they were able to control again for all of this other stuff, right? But especially when the victim was white, right? The darker skinned defendants got significantly longer sentences. The same patterns found in death sentence too. So, and again, the idea there, the hypothesis, in this case, they did not have access to either the judge or jury's implicit association test. But the idea is that that's what was going on. There was a very strong link between dark-skinned people and culpability, such that harsher sentence was given. What about education? Now, this is where I said, like, there's some really wonderful stuff that we'll talk about, hopefully, in the next couple months, specifically about discipline, and with some more direct tests of implicit bias, okay? But right now, I just wanted to give you a one slide. This is Dan Lawson did this study in North Carolina, okay? So this is racial disparities in the use of suspension for first-time offenders, okay? So what you're seeing here is the blue is white, the orange is black, okay? These are just first-time offenders, so they haven't committed the offense before. This isn't like their 73rd time with cell phone confiscation, right? But it's saying, so only your first-time offenders, right? Just those kids who just done it the first time, so you don't have any repeat people in this sample. What kind of punishment did they get? Okay? And so what you see here is this is the percent of kids of that race who were first-time offenders for cell phone dress code disruptive display of affection, and it shows the likelihood that they got out of school suspension. So with cell phone, right, there was 15% of white students who got cited for having a cell phone were suspended out of school, compared to 33% of African-American students. And remember, because they only looked at first-time offenders, repeat offending can't be. It's not like the African-American kids had a longer record of bringing cell phones, because those kids were excluded. Dress code, 17% of white students who violated dress code got suspended out of school, 38% of black students. Being disruptive. Now, this is that willful defiance piece. 24% of disruptive white students first time got suspended out of school. 40% of black students. And finally, display of affection. 15% of white students cited for the public display of affection got suspended out of school as a result, versus 43% of African Americans. One other important thing I want to add. Remember the study I was talking about, the Texas study that followed kids? They did a really amazing analysis. What they did is they said, remember when we looked at the willful defiance slide back there and we said, okay, look at how the gap grows, you know, when you go from the more objective, serious offenses to things like disruption or willful defiance or display of affection, these looser things, right? But you still saw that difference, right? You still saw that even in the category of serious stuff, African-American students were more likely, right? What they were able to do is take that same data in Texas and control for basically the effect of poverty. They basically controlled for all the other things that could be explaining it. When they controlled for all those things, okay, what they found was that white students actually had a higher likelihood of receiving a suspension for those objective serious offenses, and African American and Latino students had a much, on the other hand, higher likelihood of suspension for these subjective offenses. That means that the disparity was really being driven by what happens in this vague category. The good news is implicit bias is quite malleable to context and environment. So this is not something like, it's under our consciousness, what can we do about it? We really do know that there are both contextual stuff and personal things, kind of individual factors, that encourage or discourage implicit bias. So I want to talk about the four conditions here. These are context conditions. The first one is time constraints. And remember the students who are sorting the resumes, right? The faster they had to go, the more likely this happens. So time constraints, ambiguity, you know, again, thinking about those students, I'm pretty sure I saw the kid kissing his girlfriend or boyfriend, you know, in those cases where it was unclear. Cognitive overload, busyness. This is a multitasking one. You got too much happening. I mean, they found consistently that people show less implicit bias when they're engaging their higher level thinking, right, when they're involved. But when you're on automatic and when you have a million things happening, that's when it increases and shows up in behavior. Lack of attention being paid to the task. Like the thing that struck me about just totally clearly is that sounds pretty much like the life of a teacher, doesn't it? Or someone working in a district, time constraints, ambiguity, cognitive overload, lack of attention being paid to the task. So there's so many ways that our classroom really, our classroom and our school system sets up a context that encourages implicit bias. There are also important impact of individual mindset and implicit bias. The first thing is there's two basic ones. One is awareness of factors that influence the behavior, what we just talked about there, and motivation to deliberately direct the behavior. So if you are motivated and aware, that does show both some impact on the actual implicit bias and also significant impact on whether that implicit bias becomes behavior. Okay. But now I want to just really talk quickly in these last couple minutes here. I want to delve into what we can do to reduce implicit bias and related behaviors. In the follow-up to this, I'm going to go much deeper into what can we do in schools, but I'm still in the process of getting that information. But this is from looking at research that happened. For the most part, this research is happening in labs, okay? So there's been a lot of study of the problem, not a lot of translation of what we've learned from that into interventions, okay? So, but have been shown to work. In most cases, these are in labs, and in most cases, when they say worked, they're usually looking at either implicit behavior, implicit bias, or behavior in the next couple, like within a very short amount of time after the intervention. So they're not looking at long-term effects, okay? So the first one is reducing the contextual factors that encourage implicit bias. So those four things back there. So reducing sources of stress, including time constraints and decision-making environment, and identifying sources of ambiguity and imposing greater structure in the decision-making context. So again, right, so how can you reduce the sources of stress? How can you have teachers and folks have more control over what's going on? Identify those sources of ambiguity. And this is the idea behind wanting to get rid of vague categories of offenses like willful defiance. This is ambiguity combined with all of the stress and the time pressure that folks' the teachers face, make it more likely that implicit bias get reflected in behavior. And finally, impose greater structure in the decision-making context. And again, this is like another way that's been consistently shown to reduce the translation of implicit bias to behavior is to create routines, right? This is what I do when this happens. And that's a strength of things like positive behavioral interventions and supports or restorative justice or anything that says that gives students and teachers consistent guidelines for what to do in the face of both the behavior you want to see and the behavior you don't want to see. Okay? Step one is script, and this is very consistent. But when you provide people experience with counter-stereotypical exemplars, so basically you either present them with pictures or you ask them to think about famous black people and infamous white people. So the example they always use is like Bill Cosby and Charlie Manson. When you do that, you actually see a marked decrease in implicit bias. The third thing is increasing intergroup contact with stereotype groups, and this is crucially important. And this is one of the few kind of tests that wasn't sort of a lab piece. They looked at college freshmen who were randomly assigned. So they looked at whites randomly assigned to live with a black roommate versus those randomly assigned to live with a white. Those who were randomly assigned to live with a black roommate after one quarter exhibited less implicit prejudice than whites assigned to live with white roommate. Even just having a black researcher administer the test, the IAT test, like in a lab, decreased levels of implicit bias. So again, going back to this relationship issue, right? The relationship, the intergroup contact. Another study showed anything that involves cooperation. They had folks play a virtual game of dodgeball, essentially. And almost everyone on the white people's team was black, and they were playing against a team that was mostly white, right? And in any case, the experience of bonding with them and the team that they were up against was playing dirty and all of this stuff. After going through that, taking the test, levels of implicit bias dropped significantly. The next one is intrinsic motivation. So again, strong intrinsic motivation to reduce prejudice is effective in decreasing implicit bias and decreasing behavioral expressions of this bias. So, but this is really important to understand. Study participants in whom autonomous motivation, so that it was about them, was induced, and they did it through giving them these brochures and having discussions with them, displayed less explicit and implicit prejudice compared to the no treatment or control participants. Okay. But as you're going to see on the next slide, those who were either given, like in which you tried to get motivation through extrinsic means, either by controlling, demanding, setting up rewards and punishments, that actually increased implicit bias. So the final one is the semester-long seminar. So this was a seminar on prejudice and intergroup conflict and was associated with reduced implicit prejudice at the end of the semester. I guess as importantly, before we turn to questions, I want to talk about what doesn't work, because that's just as important. And one of the most consistent findings is this colorblind approach doesn't work. So basically what happens is when you have students exposed to this colorblind approach, it actually increases their implicit and explicit bias compared to those exposed to a multicultural approach. In other words, instructing people to assert that they are objective decision makers or that they're going to do that, you know, that we're going to be super fair in our hiring decision, it actually increased in this one study, gender and age discrimination. So it's a kind of counterintuitive thing. And it kind of leads into this next piece, which is extrinsic motivation and positive feedback don't work either. So, like, inducing extrinsic motivations to regulate prejudice and giving feedback, like, oh, you're doing really good on your egalitarian goals, or, you know, great, actually increased implicit racial prejudice. So it's weird. It's like, whereas the motivation to be non-prejudiced may lead to reduced discrimination, if you're thinking of yourself as non-prejudice, may ironically increase discrimination. So it's this very interesting counterintuitive impact. So perspective taking Engaging participants with others' perspectives by having participants imagine the thoughts, feelings, and actions of a Black individual. I should say that these last two that I'm talking about, there's evidence that this stuff works, but the particular trials of this is very light touch stuff, right? So the perspective taking, essentially, these findings really are going to echo what everyone's experience in life is, right? So just sitting there imagining you're someone else and the feelings and actions isn't going to do it. But if you are engaged personally in a powerful way that evokes emotion, then you see decreases, right? The other one is this light egalitarian multicultural value that emphasizes, and a lot of this does probably resonate with the kind of stuff that we've seen in workplaces, right? But this is really light touch stuff, asking participants to consider egalitarian values by activating egalitarian goals, like think about, and in this case, they ask them to think about failures to be objective or egalitarian. Or having participants think about multicultural values, just on that, very light touch one showed no impact on implicit bias. When you look at early interventions that managed to change implicit bias over the long term, and both were about relationships, and that brings us back again to relationships, and relationships is something that we'll talk about more in the follow-up to this, but I want to tell you about this recent study. White and Asian American participants basically showed less implicit prejudice against Latinos after they got to know a Latino peer with whom they had a common interest, okay, like same favorite book, and after they worked with her on a group activity that incorporated elements of Mexican culture. Okay, now, what was really interesting about this is a lab experiment. It was something that took like, I don't know, like 20 minutes. We're not talking about like, you know, a month-long project or something, right? But what was surprising is that the effects of this brief laboratory interaction lasted over time. So months later, participants not only expressed like greater interest in interacting with Mexican Americans, but also had somewhat more positive attitudes towards undocumented Mexican immigrants in an unrelated survey 6 months later. So that's pretty impressive stuff. Importantly, and again, this goes back to some of the themes that we saw in the last two slides, this didn't work if the project was not, if the project they did together was not focused on a non-Mexican cultural group, okay? So if it was, it didn't work if the project was focused on a non-Mexican cultural group, and it didn't work if they felt the topic had not been freely chosen. So again, this sense of autonomy is really important to reducing these unconscious biases. How much time do we have left?
I think we have about 5 minutes, and then we'll go to questions. So technically 20
okay.
minutes
sure.
for questions, yep. if you want
okay.
to open up now.
Okay. Let's see. I was going to see... I could do the video or no?
I think what do you so. Think?
Okay.
Think,
so
yeah,
I'm going to,
yeah. That's a good idea.
I think one thing to think about, like in the follow-up webinar that Sarah didn't even know I was planning, we're going to talk more about exactly the dynamics of the relationship between teacher and student and how this plays out, and especially what the student brings to this too, right? One of the things that students of color bring to schools is real doubts about belonging, right? Whether they really are a part of this. And I want everyone to think kind of, hopefully a lot of you guys will return for the next webinar, but think about what your students are bringing in with them in terms of their experiences in the world that they have been marinating in, that make them wary and that make them question whether they belong, and that ultimately I think can lead to a really negative interaction with teachers, especially when implicit bias is there, about feeling like that not belonging is being confirmed by poor treatment, and that poor treatment is based on their race. But this is a video called the bike theft video, and let me just.
I think we might be having some technical difficulties with the video. So just hold tight for a few seconds.
Okay, guys, so it seems like the video didn't work, right?
Hello?
The video didn't work? Is that right?
Yeah, the video. Sorry.
Okay.
And apparently I was, the video wasn't working.
Okay.
I think
All
also
right.
I was on mute when I was explaining to everyone that we will send out we'll definitely send out the video link and also the PowerPoint and also the recording of this webinar. So we'll go ahead and open up for questions right now. I'm so excited that you were able to do this whole presentation for us. It was amazing, even though we had some technical difficulties with sound, but I think we got all of, I at least who have seen this presentation before didn't miss anything. So all the content was there. So I can assure you that we weren't missing anything. A couple of points were a little bit softer. So if you all have any questions or anything about logistics or the content, please go ahead and use your chat functions to ask Tia and myself any questions. Or go ahead and email me because I if you are on if you're on the phone and not on listening through your computer. So we'll open up for questions now. Thank you, Tia.
Welcome. So I'm looking down here. We do have one. Can the attendees have a copy of the PowerPoint sent to their email addresses? Sarah, you want to answer that?
Yes, they can.
Okay.
So if you would email me, I will also send, if you'll email me, I will send it directly to you, and I have been doing that. Actually, a number of you emailed me while we were going through the presentation and asked for it, and I sent it. I will be sending a follow-up. There will be a follow-up communication that will have a link to a survey that would be great if all of you would take the survey about this webinar, as well as a link to our webinar archive site. And I will also send you the direct link when it is available.
Great. And so there are really important question. Here's one. How do we implement or impart this information to our staff? How in an effort to reduce suspension rates for minorities? And I think, part of it is first that, remember that slide that I showed where I said that what are the personal things? And one is understanding that this impacts and motivation. I think that we're going to get much deeper in the next webinar into actually what you can do with your staff and with the different levels of your staff quite explicitly and what you can do with your students to blunt the impact of this. But I think the first step, though, is just raising awareness. And that's really, distribute this slide deck. If you feel free to reach out to me, too, if you'd like me to talk to folks. But I think the first thing is, yes, this exists, and also to get the defensiveness down about it. I blushed when I looked at my scores, and I was alone with my computer, right? Taking that out, saying this is unconscious. Let's grapple with this without the really heavy sense, I think, of shame and how weighted it is when we talk about it. But now, it is really important stuff that has real effects on people's lives, and I think that this research begins to show us that there are real, that we're at the beginning, right, figuring out how to create conditions in workplaces that can mute the impact of this. And I think we're actually, you know, getting much closer to understanding how to do it in schools. So so part of it is this, part of that is stay tuned, okay?
Yes, and I'm really excited. Tia and I haven't talked about it, but we're on the same page that we're definitely going to do a follow-up, and we'll work together to schedule that as soon as possible.
So, this is a great question. Are there any examples of school districts that have effectively addressed racial bias and disproportionality in discipline rates? Sarah, do you want to start with that? And
So in the toolkit, we have highlights of districts who are actually tackling that head on. So they saw the problem and they're head on tackling it. So there's Principal Carrie Callahan of Woodland Joint Unified. She's attacking that by, looking at creating relationships explicitly with all of her students and with her staff, and she's a principal. And so she's making sure that, as Tia said, the relationship piece is happening at all times at her school. They have just now begun to get data in about it, so we'll find out, with this next round of toolkits, and if it's working and what is working. Also, Superintendent Ramona Bishop in Vallejo is tackling this issue head on by implementing restorative justice, which is a lot about building community and building community through restorative justice circles and also building relationships. So community building leads to relationship building with students, talking to students, figuring out where they're coming from, figuring out what they think about issues that are affecting them in their communities and at home, and how the school can serve them academically, but also socially and emotionally. So that is kind of a beginning of that. And also, I know there are some people on this webinar, for instance, San Francisco Unified School District is doing the same thing using restorative practices to build community, build relationships, and eliminate disproportionality and attack head-on their racial bias. So those are some things that are happening now, and people are in the beginning stages of attacking that head on. So I'm excited to see the improvements and anything that we know about, or if all of you have any ideas or any results that are working in your schools, let us know. We'd like to make sure that that's available for everyone.
Great. So also Oakland USD, Napa Unified School District are also doing work. Also, at the back of the slide deck that you get, I included these case studies that I've been doing of different schools showing drops in suspensions as a result of changes, usually changes that are about building relationships, and how that was, you see this steep decline in suspensions, and you see this big increase in API, which is California's standardized test. Scores, and you see also that the gains in academic achievement accrue to the just those students, poor students, English language students with those disparate rates of discipline. Let's see. We have a comment that Vallejo is also implementing school-wide positive behavioral interventions and supports. Oh, another one.
True.
Another one for Sarah. What is being done on the legislature state level to fix the suspension problem?
So there are a lot of things being done, kind of on all levels. So there's, bills, of course, around, attempting to limit the use of willful defiance and prioritize other means of correction. So in fact, in 48900.5, California Ed Code 48900.5, their other means of correction are prioritized over suspension. So suspension should be used as a last resort, and instead there are some enumerated things that should happen instead, like having a parent-teacher conference and with the student as well to build the relationship, to find out, you know, the actual root of the misbehavior, the unwanted behavior. And then there are efforts moving forward to, you know, limit, as I said, you know, the use of willful defiance and prioritize other things. In non-legislative areas, there are attempts to also influence the kind of the ways that, you know, teachers and administrators get credentials. So clear credentials. So to include guidance and training around restorative justice, positive behavior intervention and support, implicit racial bias, et cetera, having those be part of the way to get a clear credential so that everyone is on the same page as they're becoming teachers and administrators. So those are some of the things. As well, you know, public counsel offers free training and connection to all of these trainers and educators who are actually using successfully implementing successfully implementing alternatives to suspension and expulsion and reducing disproportionality. So, you know, if you want more information, definitely visit fixschooldiscipline.org, but also email me, and I have a breadth of resources to connect you with.
Yeah. Also, just quickly, another participant mentioned that, let's see, Lawndale is also implementing school-wide behavioral supports and positive behavioral supports and restorative justice, and they've changed their board policy to clearly define what willful defiance is and isn't.
Yes.
Yeah. And then finally, on this, on the slide I have up now, we have a website, www.schooldisciplinedata.org, and what this website allows you to do is look at your district and take a look for the 09-10 data, what the disparities look like. It allows you to compare your district to other districts, but we urge you to go there and take a look.
Yeah, and also I have, so in the toolkits there are there is a tool that helps you step by step with accessing and researching and analyzing data. So using the California DataQuest site, but also we have now updated it to include the schooldisciplinedata.org. So there's step by step on how you can go through. And so that's something that will be, you know, with the new round of updates that I will let everyone know when they're all uploaded to our site. So we've linked to UCLA's site as well. And that site is, I mean, from what I've gone through, I've spent a long time with it. I think it's very clear, and it definitely helps show what, especially what you were talking about with, you know, what happens when they're, a student has multiple identities, so being, you know, an African American student with disabilities and also male, what that does to suspension rates. So, and what that does to disproportionality. So you can actually see real time data as it relates to districts and different states and different districts, which I think was amazing. That's something that is new.
Oh, could you also talk about, Dan asked if you could also mention the CDE.
Oh, yes, definitely. I'm sorry. I don't
and
know.
And the position of CDE, yeah.
Right. So CDE is all the way, so California Department of Education, for those of you who are not from California on the webinar, CDE has definitely taken a very strong and supporting role in making sure that these alternatives are alternatives to suspension and expulsion are talked about and kind of promoted so that, you know, definitely taken the position that suspension and expulsion are last resorts. So things, and instead you should be looking at proactive measures. So also they have a site, and I will thank you, Dan, for reminding us. There is a site, CDE has a new proactive strategies site that has just gone up this year, and I will make sure to send everyone the link to that, to their, to the positive behavioral and discipline strategies site. That also includes highlights highlights about schools that are implementing, and then also connections, contact pages of those educators and trainers that you can contact.
Cool. Great, and I just want one last word. Someone did make a great comment about whether PBIS was enough. And I think it is really important to understand that we don't have a lot of evidence that PBIS is quite good at reducing the overall level of suspensions, and that's really, really important, and reducing them for everyone. We don't have a lot of strong evidence that it can get rid of the disparities. Now, that, you know, the disparities at lower levels, of course, mean it impacts less kids. So that's it's still important, but the idea is that there probably needs to be PBIS plus, okay? And that's what the field now is working on figuring out, but thank you for bringing that up.
Right, and I would piggyback on that, too, to say that, you know, PBIS is a framework. So it is helpful to know that it is a way to to reduce suspensions, but you also want to think about the other things that you can do within the PBIS tiers, multi-tiered framework, to create these, to focus on creating relationships and reducing disproportionality. So, for instance, there are schools that use PBIS and a mentoring system. There are others that use PBIS and restorative justice, or PBIS and social emotional learning programs. So those, and a few of them are actually in the toolkit. So Vallejo and Sac City Unified, Leotada Floyd Elementary School is using PBIS and social emotional learning. Vallejo and Woodland Joint Unified, both of the educators that I spoke about earlier, Carrie Callahan and Dr. Bishop, they're using PBIS and restorative justice. And I think Vallejo is also using another program on top of that. So just to layer in and make sure that all the gaps are filled. And I think we're about at our end. Are there any other questions, burning questions, Tia, that we should answer now, or we can go ahead and we can follow up if there, if someone asks a question.
Let's see, okay, we're going to have to follow up. There is one last question that we'll have to, the alternatives are great, but there are any examples of effective accountability measures that schools or districts are using to ensure proper implementation? So we will follow up.
Accountability measures?
Yeah,
we'll follow up. That's a big one. We'll follow up. So thank you all so much for joining and participating and asking these really great questions. As I said, I will definitely be following up with, you will receive, it's automated, but you'll receive a link to CD's website, our website, and the archival, and a survey. And I really, really, really urge you to fill out the survey so that we can continue to improve and offer relevant and helpful webinars to all of you. And I really thank Tia for all of her good information. And so I guess we'll sign off. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you guys so much.